Force as power. Power as force involves the exercise of biological and physical means to prevent another person or group from doing what she or it prefers to do, or to get something to happen to the person or group that she or it would prefer it did not. The force utilized may involve the infliction of bodily pain or injury, including the destruction of life itself and the frustration of basic biological needs. It may also involve the construction of human and physical obstacles to constrain or restrict the freedom and range of movement of another person or group. Force may be utilized instrumentally rather than directly to achieve certain ends. The instrumental use of force may involve its use to inhibit or destroy another person's or group's ability to develop and mobilize its human and material resources, which might be used against the interests of the powers that be. The strategic and tactical purpose of instrumental force is to limit or eliminate the subordinate individual's or group's capacity to act in certain ways. Instrumental force may be used to establish in the mind of the subordinate person or group the power holder's capability and willingness to use force as an instrument of punishment for non-compliant behavior on her part or its part. It also may be used as a means of motivating the non-complying party to return to or to reestablish a pre-existing power relation. Force per se, rather than being utilized as the primary and exclusive means of exerting power over another, may serve more to reinforce or back up other forms of power relations. That is, force, although a reality in many social situations, achieves its full scope by undergirding other types of power. In so-called advanced societies like the United States, force is more likely to be applied as the final persuader or arbiter when compliance is not attained by other means. Force as inefficient power. In the context of the modern nation-state, the use of force as the primary regulator of social and power relations, as the primary means of achieving the results desired by power holders, is more often than not inefficient, counterproductive, and fraught with onerous complexities and unintended outcomes. It is also often socially, economically, and materially costly to exert and maintain. Wrong perceptively notes as follows. Force is more effective in preventing or restricting people from acting than in causing them to act in a given way. Force can achieve negative effects, the destruction, prevention, or limitation of the possibility of action by others. But one cannot forcibly manipulate the limbs and bodies of others in order to achieve complex positive results. The fabrication or construction of something, the operation of a machine, the performance of a physical or mental skill. Wardenberg further notes, force is uneconomic for a number of reasons. In the first place, it requires that the dominant agent make some physical effort in order to keep the subordinate agent from doing what she would otherwise do. As a result, maintaining the use of force requires a constant expenditure of energy by the dominant agent. Force is also uneconomic because it inherently occasions resistance. It is always perceived by those over whom it is used as a hostile presence, an alienating experience that restricts their ability to act. Because of this, it engenders a dynamic of resistance in those over whom it is exercised. Thus, force by itself is less effective as a means of power than is often assumed. The problematics of using unadorned force as the chief instrument of power utilized by a dominant group to achieve complex social material ends with economic efficiency and the barest minimum of social disruption motivates that group to develop and apply more subtle forms of power. However, at this juncture, we should note that current forms of domination of continental, Caribbean, North, Central, and South American Africans, respectively by Europeans, is secured by more subtle and efficient means of political control than by the use of oppressive physical force. Consequently, the independence of African countries and former Caribbean colonies and the social assimilation of African Americans into the mainstream of white America by no means represent the lessening of European and Euro-American domination of or a fundamental change in the nature of European and African power relations in favor of the Africans, as persons so erroneously assume. Quite to the contrary, these historically apparent social political changes instead represent the increased subtlety and efficiency of European domination of African people. It should be noted that the ability to use physical, militaristic force as the final arbiter of power relations still lies overwhelmingly in the hands of Europeans and Euro-Americans. It is this force differential that Africans across the diaspora must in some way resolve, neutralize, or frustrate if they are to gain true parity with Europeans and Euro-Americans and indeed gain their liberation from European domination. Psychic violence. The most powerful obstacle against the liberation of African peoples from white domination and exploitation is not the ability of whites to use superior military or police firepower or their threat to use it against African insurgency, but is their ability to engage in unrelenting psycho-political violence against the collective African psyche. It is the white monopoly on psychic violence and their devastatingly ingenious use of it against the minds of African peoples which represent the greatest threat to African survival. Wrong insightfully points out the nature of this form of violence. There is a form of conduct, often described as psychic, psychological, or moral force or violence, which does not fit readily under the rubrics of any of the other forms of power. If physical violence involves inflicting damages on the body of a person, how is one to classify the deliberate effort to affect adversely a person's emotions or her feelings and ideas about herself by verbally or in other symbolic ways insulting or degrading her? If power includes the production of purely mental or emotional effects and is not confined to the eliciting or overt acts, then the psychic assault of, say, a nagging, browbeating spouse or parent, the defamation of the character of a political foe, or even of an entire group, constitute exercises of power. Damage to the psyche is surely as real as damage to the body. It is plainly not true that sticks and stones may break my bones, but names can never hurt me. Psychic violence, in which the intended effect of the perpetrator is to inflict mental or emotional harm, is continuous with physical violence. The ultimate force in the world is the force of mind. When that force is defeated, all is lost. Dominant whites have used words and symbols to violently and unrelentingly attack oppressed blacks in 1,001 nefarious ways, including the projection of dehumanizing stereotypes and caricatures of them, the falsification of their history and culture, the miseducation of blacks, and the engaging in chronic derisive media attacks on their morals, behavior, intelligence, ways of life, sexuality, physical appearance, motives, and values. The final end of the violent white instigated psychic assaults against the collective psyche of blacks is to induce in them states of false consciousness, self-alienation, and self-hatred so as to irreparably impair their capacity to overthrow their white oppressors through the mobilization of their human and material resources. False consciousness, self-alienation, and self-hatred are conjoining states of mind which motivate oppressed blacks to engage in continuing self-defeating, self-destructive assaults against their own interest and against themselves. Consequently, by these means, blacks are unwittingly manipulated into forming alliances with their oppressors and exploiters in disempowering themselves and in empowering those who dominate and exploit them all the more.